Welcome to Just a Few More Minutes podcast, where three veterans of the animation and video game industry talk about exactly that, animation and video games. I am one of your hosts. I'm a supervising animator at Blue Sky Studios. My name
Arrogant.
Is Jeff Gabor.
Arrogant.
I should start with my name first, then my title.
Title before your name.
Yeah.
Dick.
Yeah. The guy next to me is...
That has a lesser title, so I'm Michael. I'm Michael. Goodbye.
Animator. And then... way out in bumfuck Egypt is Mr. Pete Paquette. Say hi, Pete.
Hello.
Oh, there he is.
That's a nice delay.
And there's another voice you're hearing right now. We hear some chuckles from the one and only Mike Walling.
Woo!
Hello, hello, hello.
Welcome.
Thank
to
you
show.
For having me all the way out here in Seattle.
Yeah.
Washington.
Damn, you're actually in Seattle? That's cool. We're like coast to coast right now.
We are.
Yeah.
Pretty neat.
So we had such a good response to the interview that we had with Pete about his career that we figured, why not? Let's dive into that again. And I thought of who has such a great story, and Mike Walling came to mind.
So it's a weird one.
Yeah, figure why not dive into his arc?
I'm excited. I don't know this beautiful arc. I know parts of it, but not all of it.
Yeah. I think my story is proof that there's no direct line usually ever into what it is you want to do sometimes. I know there are those rare people who just say, I'm going to be an animator, and they just, you know, they're just good at it and they get a job, you know. And then there are people like me that are like, I'm going to go work at the Disney store, you know, and like, that'll give me a job, you know.
All right, so let's get the other shit out of the way, because this is animation and video games. I'm sure we got some news, right?
Wait, do we have an animation tip?
No, we're doing all the animation stuff. Like, the animation tip is there's no direct line into this, and Mike will tell you about it.
Just the animation tip.
Because I do have a tip, but I'll save it for later.
Okay. Are you going to remember it?
Yeah, I'm not sure I can.
It's like my one tip that guides me forth through the vagina.
Don't think?
No.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll save it, you know? People are going to blow their dicks when they hear it, man.
Okay. All right.
It's like something to look forward to later, I guess.
Pete, are you high? Are you there?
Oh, I'm here, man.
Okay.
I'm actually sober tonight.
Oh, sweet. Nice. All right.
Because I got to go and get a Super Nintendo after this.
Is that part of the news? Good segue, my friend.
I just got one today from... I got one today from my friend who works at Nintendo here in Kirkland.
Wait, so you already have it?
She hooked me up. Yeah.
God,
well,
damn.
No. She has it in her car. I'm hoping she'll bring it over tonight. If not, I got to meet with her tomorrow and go pick it up, because she works in Kirkland. So
nice,
very lucky.
I'm gonna be
sleeping at Best Buy tonight. So,
oh my god, yeah, it helps to have a friend who works there. But even with her discount, it's like I think I got $7 off of the price.
Yeah.
At least you got
that makes
one.
Sense. The news for this week, there really isn't anything all that redeeming. The most interesting thing I found was that Inside is going to be coming out for the Switch.
Woo!
Right on.
That is awesome.
Give them more money. I'll definitely buy it again.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
That's cool. I just played that about 2 weeks ago. And,
oh, yeah? What did you think?
Definitely. It was actually kind of nice, because it wasn't the typical stuff I've been playing lately. And so kind of an odd story, but a lot of physics-based stuff. And I liked how, some of the animation is really good, actually.
Yeah.
I feel like. And then I liked some of the systems, how you would approach a thing to do and it would kind of kick in, but it felt pretty natural. It was pretty well done. A very odd ending, but I kind of expected it. All along I was like, this is gonna end so fucked. I just know it, you know. And then it ended. I was like, yep, there it is. That's one scene later than I was expecting it to end.
All right, let's talk just real quick. Yeah. Spoilers. Can we talk spoilers?
Yeah. We've covered this shit. Go back and listen to the other episodes.
All right.
But Walling, I think he was Michael Berardini, that guy over there right next to me that I'm pointing at.
Yeah.
I think he's the one that pointed out to me, if you look at the story in that the character that you play, the boy, if you look at, like, go back through the story and that whole time you're playing as him, you're actually being controlled by that thing at the end of the movie. And it completely does a whole new perspective on the entire game.
Right, so, I kind of get that.
Yeah, technically you play as the blob thing the whole time.
Sure.
Right.
Yeah, it's like, I kind of got that, because you're basically being pushed around to that end result, right? To basically, I guess, escape and then just die on the beach.
Yeah.
But
interesting tidbit, that beach is foreshadowed in like a little diorama previously when you're like massacring people as the blob. So you might have just gone into a bigger cage.
I missed it. Mm. Right. That's a good way to put it, actually. I like that.
That's deep, man.
That's a good ass game, man.
But I what I thought was interesting too was the violence in the deaths was fun.
Yeah. Did you play their first game, Inside? No.
No.
Limbo.
Oh, Limbo. Yeah, I haven't played Limbo yet. But I was going to, and then one of my managers was like, "Don't bother. If you're gonna play Inside, just play Inside."
You know? I think Limbo is cool. It's nice to see where they came from, because that is like 2D, but it looks like Inside. Also, I'm taking my shoes off, popping them off. Sorry, nice. My feet are stinky, motherfucker.
Nice.
You work too hard if they're stinky. But, like, I remember when Limbo first came out, all those deaths, and you play the little boy in that one, too. They're just so fucking gruesome and awesome.
I love it. I wouldn't even call them that gruesome, but they feel real.
I was going to say, it's not that it's like gruesome, but it's just violent, and it's somehow relatable. Like when I'm climbing that chain link fence because the dogs are running back and forth, and I'm just like, oh shit, I can just feel like my ass curl up inside my body, you know? Yeah. It's like, no. And it's like, you know, you're running across the floor out of the pool of water, and it's like, here it comes, and I don't think I'm gonna make that gap jump, and then he like grabs you and this is like rips into you, and you're just like, oh, that was painful. Yeah. You know, but very simplistic and well done though in terms of the communication of violence, you know. And then getting shot was like matter of fact, like there he is, right, and you're just like dead in the water face down. But it was fun. It was different.
It's a good ass game right there.
Yeah. Oh,
not to completely change the subject, but the Stranger Things is coming out soon.
Yeah, Halloween.
This game, game reminds me of Stranger Things.
Based on the show, or
no, just the Inside reminds him of Stranger Things.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I've been putting off that show.
Oh,
you definitely should watch it. Me and
I will.
Just talking about, we're probably gonna rewatch it this month.
Oh, I just already started rewatching it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And now that we're speaking of Stranger Things, reminds me of I saw It.
Oh yeah.
I won't like go into a full in-depth review, but it definitely felt like a longer, slightly scarier version, an episode of Stranger Things. Even though I know Stranger Things is like basically just building off of the nostalgia of these types of Stephen King stories, but
that's cool.
Yeah, it was fun.
That's awesome. I have to see that too. Ever since the baby came, I don't have time for anything.
Oh, yes. Congrats, Walling.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Papa. Yeah, it's cool.
That's awesome, dude.
He's pretty rad. And the kids love him, so.
Does he do tricks or something?
He does the best trick.
Flips.
He does the best trick. He doesn't cry much.
Oh!
That is the best trick.
It is the best trick. He's pretty chill. I can't thank him enough. So, yeah. He's pretty awesome, though. He's been a good addition to the family, so. And my daughter, you know, Autumn likes pushing him around in the stroller, so. But you know what's funny? I don't want to derail the podcast, but it is funny that my son reminded me, you know, Dylan reminded me, like, hey, when he's 5, I'll be in college. I was like, oh, oh my God. You know?
Jesus.
And it's like, nothing put perspective in me like that did, you know. It's like, oh my God, you know, you're going to be driving soon. Like in 2 years, he'll be taking his permit, you know. And
that's insane.
You
man.
Definitely wow. hit the reset button on all that stuff.
Right. Well, that was the thing. It's like, you know, my wife was like, if you want to be with me, you got to give me a baby. And I said, well, you can have one. And that's it, you know. And but it was a long negotiation. So, and then I asked a buddy at DreamWorks one day, I was like, man, would you ever like have kids again? And he's like, fuck yeah, man, kids are awesome. Why not? And I was like, okay. And I kind of took that to heart for some reason. And I was like, yeah, what's the worst that can happen? I could be in an old folks home and he can be in college, you know. It's the worst that could happen, you know. Or I just die of a heart attack at my desk, you know, because all the stress. But anyway, okay, all right.
Yeah, all right, back on top. The only other news we have, right? All right, so there was the SNES Mini, and also tonight, well, mm-hmm. I guess this will be, by the time you hear this, it'll already be out. Cuphead finally comes out.
Woo!
Yeah, Cuphead.
Cuphead is this like hyper hand animated Fleischer Studio type animation video game that's been anticipated for well over a year.
Okay.
So it's been delayed and it's finally coming out tonight.
Tell me what you mean by hyper animated.
Okay. Well, I was searching for
it's
words.
It's animated.
Well, no, I mean, I guess I just mean by it's traditional. That's what I just mean. Like it's.
Yeah.
Literally hand-drawn.
Yeah.
And it's really, like, well done as far as the blending goes from, like, you know, different states and stuff like that. It's pretty seamless.
That's cool. I love that.
It looks That's hot cool. as F.
Is it on Switch or, like, a console?
It's only on Xbox.
No, it's on PC, too.
Is it? Well, okay. Yeah. Well, it's published by Microsoft, though, I think.
Mm. So, yeah, I'm getting kind of tired of that whole, like, exclusive to a console, you know.
Yeah
I pretty annoying. Much want everything on my Switch now. Like I would buy most games twice if I could get it on Switch too.
Yeah,
aren't they trying to Microsoft's been trying to bridge the gap for that with Rocket League.
Oh, that's already running right now.
Is it?
Yeah, I mean, you can cross platform with PC players.
Yeah,
and then it will cross platform with cool. Switch.
It'll never cross-platform with PlayStation.
Yeah, Sony said, fuck you.
Yeah.
Thanks, Sony. Thanks for squashing my dreams.
I know.
Yeah. Hmm. All right, so moving on.
Right.
That's it for news. So I figure we would start, before we get into the interview, we'll just play a small game.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Because this will...
Do I have to not look at the screen?
Yeah, you can't look at the screen even though you fucking cheated already.
Dude, fuck off. I was looking. You had it up on the screen. I didn't know I wasn't supposed to look at it. It's your fault.
All right. So, like games before, I encourage listeners to see if they can try to beat our contestants in terms of time. But for you, Mike, and Pete, and... Oh, shit, we have two people named Mike. You have to say...
You never call me Mike.
You can call me Herbie.
Okay, what, Michael? No, we're not doing that. You want to call Bird? Bird.
Yeah, Bird.
All right, so call out your name as your buzzer. And
wait, I have to say Bird?
You have to say Bird.
Oh, I'm not used to that.
All right, so the first person I hear call their name, and then they get to have their guess, all right? We have 10. We have 10.
Explain the rules of the game.
So first, all right, I'm going to play some music. Okay. I'm going to play some music. These are all based off, these are themes from movies. When you recognize the movie, say your name.
And so we're guessing the movie.
Guess the movie.
Not the composer.
Well, okay.
Thank God.
Can you get extra points if you name the composer?
No.
Are you sure?
Yes, I just said that. I am the god.
You refer to yourself as a god way too fucking frequently.
You haven't learned by now that Jeff is egotistical and he's power hungry. Come on,
that's the one.
And he's clingy.
He's clingy. No, just clingy in a, like a passive aggressive way.
Yes.
Yeah.
All right, don't look at the screen anymore.
Okay, I'm like looking down and covering. I promise. You can tell because my voice isn't in the microphone.
All right, Walling, you could hear that Zelda music before, right?
Here, the intro music? Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Good. So that means this should work. yep, I see that. I see that. Let's turn it up a bit so everybody can hear it. All right, number one. All right, remember, say your name. This is starting out rough. I shouldn't have started with a hard one. No?
Pete.
All right, Pete.
Pause it.
The Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants.
You idiot.
I don't fucking know.
I feel like this is one of the ones that I accidentally saw. Oh.
He just saw it.
He looked at the goddamn screen.
Why would you name it the name of the movie? Name the track 1, 2, 3.
All right, now it's up to Walling. Walling, can you get it? Because Michael's disqualified.
I'm going to say The Notebook.
All right. No points are awarded this round.
Are we doing specific genres, or is this like all over the place? Like
yeah, all over the place.
Oh God,
man.
Okay.
Don't look.
So you're gonna say who that was?
Are you gonna say the name of the movie?
Yeah, I will. But I'm gonna try to play it again because it just crashed. Don't look at the screen, you bastard!
I don't know what's happening.
You just don't have to look at the screen. You don't have to bury yourself.
It's
was he going to play the ostrich mode over there?
Yes. All right, let me go deeper into the song, see if it helps.
It doesn't.
Yeah. See, it might. Huh?
Strings like that are used in everything.
All right, RP.
Okay.
I'm going to say Blade Runner.
Okay. All right. No, don't look at this goddamn
stop! I didn't look. Fucking rotate the thing if it's such an issue.
All right, we are. We're rotating the goddamn screen.
Fuck why?
All right, that was Sixth Sense.
Not known for its music, that movie.
All right. Here we go. We'll fucking do an easy one. Get ready to say your name as fast as possible.
Okay.
Pete.
Pete.
Terminator.
No. Keep Bird. Going. Yep, Pete. Bird.
Terminator 2.
That's right.
All right.
Go fuck yourself.
I was going to say, how specific?
I mean, that music doesn't play in Terminator, does it?
I have no idea. He just said Terminator, sure? So I went Terminator 2.
Well, not with these specific instruments.
Maybe. There was no inherent horn in the first movie.
All right, we have one for Bird.
Why is this so hard? What? Oh wait, no, Bird.
Yeah.
Ace Ventura 2: When Nature Calls.
Yeah.
Really?
Really? Oh God.
Oh, that's fucked up that you know that.
I promise I did not see that one.
Yeah,
I loved that movie when I was a kid. All
right, 2-0-0.
The Bat-Wano.
Are you ready for number 3?
Yeah.
Here you go.
Pete.
Yeah.
Curb Your Enthusiasm.
No, it doesn't sound like it, though.
RP.
Yeah.
I'm gonna say chitty chitty bang bang. Come on, it sounds like a Dick Van Dyke movie. Whatever you're playing.
Play more.
All right, yeah, keep playing. I don't know why it's crashing.
Whoa. Some shitty 80s movie.
Yeah, License to Drive or something.
Weekend at Bernie's.
That's a great guess.
It'll help give it away in just a second when it hits the...
Heartbeat. Is it Captain Ron?
Berardini. Huh. The weatherman.
All right, fuck it. We're done. We're done with it. I thought that was going to be an easy one. I thought that was
a no fucking clue.
That is Groundhog's Day.
Oh.
Mm.
Seen that movie like once.
Oh, it's man. A great movie. You can't see Groundhog's Day because it...
You know what's funny, though?
No, I get it.
I've seen that movie probably 30 times, and I don't remember that song at all. It must be like the beginning or something.
All right, next one. Opening credits. Clearly picked horrible movies.
Let me just ask, did you genuinely know any of this shit?
Yes.
Which ones so far?
I feel like I would know all of these. I've picked ones I thought I would be able to do.
Believe you at all.
All right, next one. Here we go. Get ready to say your fucking names.
Okay. Mike Berardini. Matrix.
Yes.
Damn it.
This is getting to be a blowout. Here we go.
It's really hard for me to say the right word. My name. Is it playing?
Yeah, it's playing.
Good Lord.
Yeah, it's... We're gonna get copyright strike again.
Hmm. That's definitely John Williams.
We're letting it play way too much. Like, we're gonna get serious copyright strikes for this stuff.
Whatever.
The longest build-up to a movie theme I've ever heard.
I have a guess. Berardini. Minority Report?
No. All right, I'll start just tossing out clues. I'll say yes to John Williams.
No shit.
So violent.
Early Steven Spielberg.
Jaws?
All right, I'm going to say...
All right, hold on.
Close Encounters of the Third Kind.
It is that.
Yeah. Ooh, good.
All right. Wong's on the board.
All right.
I should have said my name, though. I apologize.
It's all right. Here we know go. Your voice now. Your sweet, beautiful voice.
Pete.
Pete?
Amelie?
It is Amelie.
That's not fair. It's like, oh, French music. The one French movie everybody knows.
All right, here we go.
Good guess.
Digging this.
Harvey. I'm gonna say oh god, what's it called? It's the Michael J. Fox as a werewolf movie.
No.
Teen Wolf.
No. Very comical guess, so for me.
Wow, let's just listen to this though.
Okay. I'm going to say Howard the Duck. No, okay.
I will eliminate the 80s for you, Walling.
I mean, I'll just throw it out there. Stranger Things?
No.
Okay.
I'm actually shocked you don't. You're not, like, jumping on this.
Me too. Because I dig it.
Yeah. Jesus of Nazareth.
All right, we're going to call it.
But, like, is that from the soundtrack or the score?
Oh.
I think this is the... Oof.
Because you might have just fucked everything up. Not that I have any idea what that is.
I will say, I specifically associate this song with the movie, so that's why I...
Movies?
Movie.
I don't know.
Drive.
Oh, Drive. Never. Dude. Okay.
I don't think I ever saw that movie.
That's Cliff Martinez. He's my favorite composer.
Here we go.
I didn't know that song.
Yeah, this is very similar.
Okay. Some Christmas shit.
Oh my god.
Berardini. Into the Woods?
No. Oh my god, RV.
Yeah?
It's William Wonka and the Chocolate Factory.
Oh yeah! Wow. It's getting close now.
I knew.
It's getting close.
This is one of those.
Because I gotta go and take it, bitches.
Let's reiterate bitches. The score. Do you remember the score?
What do you mean the score? Oh, yes.
The score of the game that we're playing?
Yes. It's 1-2-3.
Okay.
1-2.
It's Pete at 1, okay. Walling at 2, Michael at... or Bird at 3.
Yeah.
So I believe this is our final...
6.
This is our final one. Yeah. <He's the excellent.
laughs> TikTok, you don't talk. Or you don't stop, I don't know. Is it playing?
Yeah, it's playing.
Yeah, it is.
Just uncomfortable silence.
Berardini. American Beauty.
Because you saw this one, you saw it.
I guarantee I would have known it. Regardless, though, it's Thomas Newman.
I'm okay giving it to him.
All right. Jesus, Riley, calm down your phone. What is going on?
My phone.
Oh, you got some major background noise.
You want some of the best Thomas Newman?
I'm going to close my window then. I got kids in the outside playing. Bastard. Hang on.
Road to Perdition. That is the best Thomas Newman score, IMO.
All right, we're into this far enough that we should let's get into the nitty gritty.
Okay, so, I hope that's better.
Mr. Mike Walling, you are in the animation industry for years. You also double as being in the video game industry as well. But how did you get there? Like, what made you start getting into the industry or wanting to be an animator?
Yeah, I started late, actually. I think I got my first job at 28. My God.
Dang.
And my first paying gig as an animator, you know.
Well, what were you doing just before that?
I was teaching martial arts. And I kind of assumed I was going to always do that because I had been doing that all the way through just like high school. And then into my 20s, I was doing martial arts. And then, I don't know, one day I kind of woke up and I was like, you know what? I'm kind of tired of this. I'm tired of being sore all the time. And I'm tired of my nights being taken up. And my weekends were always like tournaments and kids sleepovers at the studio and like events and all this stuff. And so I was like, I had no life. And they literally were paying me garbage, you know? Yeah. And the guy who owned the martial arts studio, he was he was pretty manipulative in terms of, he would tell me, like, you know, stay home as long as you can with your parents, and you don't need to move out, and you don't need to get married and stuff and have a life, because he didn't want to pay me, you know. And he just wanted me to work for a minimum wage, basically, you know.
That's so stupid. I was talking.
Right. And so I was talking to another instructor who really wasn't teaching much anymore. He would just visit the studio, right? And he owned a screen print studio where he did hats and t-shirts and stuff, you know. And he told me he needed someone to come in and do a bunch of Photoshop cleanup, and like photo stats for jobs they were running. And so I'd always been kind of wanting to do creative stuff. And so I was like, sure, I can do that. So I quit the martial arts studio and then went to go really get my first job with this guy, you know. And he owned this business in like this industrial park. And so I started working with him, and he was really kind of a douchebag. And it wasn't going to work out very well, but I did it for quite a while. I think I was there for maybe not quite a year or so, and we didn't mesh well. And he had this other guy, Tim, who was a screen printer as well, and his wife worked in the office with the owner. And they would, like, ply everybody with liquor on the weekends, at, like, barbecues and stuff, and then, like, talk crap about the owner, and then we would, like, jump in on it, and then they would go back and tell the owner everything we said, basically. You know,
sweet.
And yeah, it was fun. So anyway, this job came in one day from Activision. I think it was Bubsy the Coyote. They were doing some shirt giveaway at like an E3 kind of convention, and so he asked me to clean up the artwork because we got this artwork faxed to us, and it was really like kind of mangled. And he had a light table there with a peg bar and stuff. And so I started drawing this character, and I just suddenly, I don't know what happened, but I just got this like, oh my God, this feels like what, when I watch the animated cartoons, this feels like what that must be like to draw them, you know? And I suddenly had this little itch to go watch Disney films. And so I went and I bought every Disney movie I could find, and I started watching them from a different perspective, and I just got immediately hooked on animation. I don't know what it was, but you know, I was like, that was it.
Had you drawn before that at all?
Yeah. Oh yeah, I did. I used to do a lot of pencil art, but I mean, like, really, like, long sit down over like weeks and draw like portraiture stuff. And I used to draw, like, you know, sports figures and things, and a lot of pencil shading and really intricate detail, but never like gesture drawing, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah.
You know? So yeah, so I got the bug, and it's really interesting because every success I've had, if you want to call it that, in the career has been always on the back of a failure or some kind of tragedy. You know, because I really feel like if you get too comfortable someplace, you'll just sit there forever, you know, unless you like really love that. And if you're truly happy and you're a master at your craft, then that's great. But I think that when you're in areas where you are maybe aren't in the best place, sometimes you need to push out of the nest, right? And so that was Dominic, the owner of that shop. He basically fired me. Huh. And he said, it's not going to work out, I'm letting you go. And I was like, okay. And I said, well, I want to be an animator anyway. This is the chance to go take the step towards that. And he said, well, I hope you do it. You know, he was cool. He was just like, no, this isn't going to work out, but good luck. You know, I hope it works out for you, you know. So from there, I just started thinking about how the hell am I going to do this? Because back then there was no online animation schools. There was very few books. There was The Illusion of Life at the time, and I think Preston Blair's Art of Animation book. And that was it, kind of.
Yeah.
And then the 3D phase hadn't started yet. This is pre-1995. And so there was no 3D yet. It was like all 2D. And so I was trying to do the Disney thing. And I learned it was pretty much a mystery. Like, you know, there was the apprenticeship thing, but you had to have talent really to like do that kind of thing. And so I started like thinking of schemes of like how I could get my foot in the door, you know. And obviously, I mean, honestly, super, super just naive on how the world worked, you know. I mean, really. I mean, to do martial arts my entire, you know, high school through like college and not having had a job other than that. I didn't know how things worked, you know.
Yeah.
But I did a bunch of drawings from magazines and put a portfolio together, and I sent it to Disney. Like, I want a job, you know. And I got. And what was funny is that, you know, I didn't know what to expect, you know. And I actually addressed the envelope to Glenn King.
I did not know that.
Yeah.
That's smart.
Yeah.
Glenn King.
Give me a job.
I basically just said, what can I do to learn animation to get to the level of you guys, you know, to do this thing, you know. And I was hell-bent. Like, I for the first time in my life, I'd made a decision to do something, and I was going to do it no matter what. Like, nobody was going to tell me otherwise at this point, you know.
Yeah.
And that was invigorating, because I'd never had that kind of conviction with myself at that point, you know, up until that point. So what was cool, though, is they sent me back a sample portfolio. Like, 2 weeks later, I got this big package in the mail, and I was like, holy shit, Disney wrote back, you know. And I thought it was going to be like, you know, a thank you letter from Glenn King, but it was just like a studio, like, thank you for contacting the Walt Disney Studios. And inside is the sample portfolio. And all it was like 15, 20 pages of quick sketches, life drawing.
Yeah.
And so I was like, oh, okay. I'm like, I don't get it. That's just scribbles. They're just drawing scribbles. Like, anyone can do that. How's that translate to Disney animation? You know, I did not get it at all, you know. And so I thought, well, I better go to school. So I took a course at De Anza College in Los Gatos, California. And the woman who was teaching the animation course, I didn't know a lot, but I quickly realized she was a total hack. Because, you know, I quickly realized that she was one of those that taught and didn't do. And she just basically would walk around the class and tell us to draw circles and then just bash the studios that she'd worked at, you know. She bashed everybody. And so that wasn't going anywhere. And then I was talking to somebody and they said, yeah, you know, if you get a job at the Disney store, they give you this laminated card and you can get on the lot down in Los Angeles. And I was like, that's for me, you know? And so I literally went to I forgot the name of the mall, Fairfield Mall or whatever in the Bay Area. And I applied for a job at the Disney store for seasonal to work during the Christmas season. And they like immediately hired me. And they told me I had to shave off my facial hair. And I was like, whatever. You know, I just was like, I'll do it, you know.
Whatever.
And they gave me this, right. And they just gave me this terrible uniform to wear. And they put me as a greeter at the door, like, welcome to the Disney store. Can I help you buy something, you know? And sure enough, though, I got this card like a month later. That was like laminated, and I was an employee of the Walt Disney Company, basically. And so what I started doing is you guys can hear me, right?
Yep. Oh yeah. Yeah, we're
here. Yeah.
Cool. So what I started doing was I started going down to the Disney lot on my days off. And I only worked part time at the time. And so I would drive 5 hours from the Bay Area down to LA on weekdays, days off. And I would park down like some side street somewhere down off, you know, behind the lot. And I would walk into the Walt Disney like feature building and look at all the cases of all the sculptures and stuff, you know. And then I'd wait for people who were interesting to come out. Like, I remember I would wait for like Eric Goldberg to come and he would come out. And I would walk behind him onto the lot because they'd have lunch over there, right? And so I'd go over there and I would just walk around, and I quickly realized that it wasn't going to get me anything because you couldn't really talk to the guys. And I was like, I quickly realized, like, what's the end game here? There really is an end game, you know.
That's a good value. Stalking doesn't get you a job.
right. And it wasn't even like stalking as much as it was like, okay, now I'm here, but now what? Like, what is...
Yeah.
What would be my next step, right? Because, you know, I didn't have the balls to go up to any of them and go like, hey, I work at the Disney store. I want to be an animator. What do I got to do? Can you imagine, right? So it, in the end, it kind of became like just kind of fun to go down and like look at celebrities. And I remember having conversations with like Henry Winkler and Joe Pesci and stuff, like, because they were doing work on the lot, you know, and they're super nice guys. And I would go have lunch there and stuff. And, you know, and back then, though, here's the thing that was really cool. Back then, the Disney Vault, where all the artwork was just out. It was down in this like basement, and you could just go in. They didn't ask who you were, and they would give you some white gloves. You could just go through all the artwork.
Just the absurdity that anybody working at the Disney store could take the entire history of Disney with them.
Right. Well, you couldn't leave with it, but they had like this just giant room, and they had these giant tables. And then drawers underneath the tables, and you could just go open the drawers and pull artwork out, like original map paintings and artwork that was done by all these, like the nine old men from like all the movies.
It's pretty awesome. And
yeah, and to sit there and just look at those pencil drawings was incredible. You know, it was really incredible, you know. So long story short, I go back to just working in the Disney store, which was really... Retail sucks, man. You know, retail is hard.
Yeah, it is.
And I remember one night being at the door welcoming people, and this guy walks in, and he had a PDI jacket, PDI Dreamworks. And I was like, oh, I know what they are because of my art class I took, you know, my animation class. So I walked up, and I'm like, hey, welcome to the Disney store. Can I help you? And he's like, no. And then I was like, so, couldn't help but notice the jacket. You know, like instantly was like, you work at PDI? And he's like, yeah. And I said, what do you do there? And he said, oh, I'm a producer. I do commercials. I was like, oh, that's awesome. And I said, well, I'm going to get a job there, and I'll see you on my first day. And he like laughed, and that was it, you know? And then sometime that week or two, cause I was only, I think I worked there just through Christmas. It was like 3 months, maybe 2 months. But one night I was at the door, and a buddy of mine came in who was an instructor at the karate studio I quit. His name was Jason Jeffries. And he walked in, and he was like, what the hell are you doing? Because, you know, to go from like, I'm at the door, you know. And he like, his jaw dropped. And he was like, rock bottom? You know. And so I told him what I was doing. I go, no, I'm trying to shift careers here, you know, and retail is my way in. And he just simply beautifully said, well, you know, Jan works at PDI, and Jan was another instructor that we knew who taught a couple nights a week at the studio, but then she had a day job at PDI Dreamworks. And I was like, oh my God, you're kidding me. And so he's like, yep, you can just probably call her, you know, dumbass. And then that was it. So I did. I called her up. I cold called her at PDI. And she was like, hey, what's going on, Mike? And I said, hey, you know, I'm taking some animation classes. And I said, you know, one of my assignments is to interview someone in the industry. And I said, well, why not you, you know? And then she just said, what do you really want? Like, what do you want? Well, come on. You know, and I said, well, I want to be an animator. I want a job, I'll be honest. And she's like, okay, well, I have a PA position available. I can get you an interview for that. And I was like, hell yeah. I was like, production assistant? I mean, that sounds amazing. I could be someone's assistant, and I can, you know, do cool stuff and take notes and be part of important meetings, you know.
Yeah.
And then I interviewed, and it was a long interview. I had to interview with other people, against other people. So they didn't just give me a job. I had to go through this 8-hour interview with like 45 people.
Dang, for a PA?
That's insane.
PA. Yeah.
That's crazy, man.
So it was all day, and it was exhausting. And they called me 2 days later and offered me the job.
Did they tell you what they were working on at the time?
They said they were heavily involved in commercial work. They were doing a lot of Doughboy commercials and Jet Dry commercials, yeah. Like dishwasher.
So exciting.
And Listerine commercials. And then they were working on, obviously, visual effects work for movies. But then they said they were they just signed with DreamWorks, and they were working on their first feature film, you know. Actually, let me back up. The moment I realized I could do 3D, though, was I remember being in a theater. I think I was like, I forgot what movie I was there to see, but I was watching the previews, and this movie Toy Story came on, this trailer for Toy Story. And I didn't understand what the hell I was looking at. I was like, I don't get it. It looks like those old Holiday 2, like stop motion.
Yeah, like the Rankin Bass stuff.
Yeah, and I didn't get, I was like, I don't understand. You know, the first ever 3D film, and I was like, huh? You know, and so I looked into it, and I found out that it was computer animation, and I was like, holy shit, I may not be able to draw great, but I can move puppets. And I was like, I think I could do 3D. So that's when I kind of pursued like the 3D thing. So this was like mid-95 probably. So anyway, so now we're 96 when I got the interview at PDI. And so I got the offer, and it was $8.25 an hour to go do this PA job. And on my first day, I learned what a PA really does. And here's the thing, though. There were lots of PAs at PDI. There were what they call like production PAs, and then there was what I was going to be, which was a facilities PA. You know, and Jan ran the facilities. So I learned on my first day that I was going to be emptying out ashtrays, and I was going to be doing grocery store runs to go buy food for the animators and other artists. And I learned that I was going to order toner and fax machine parts, and I learned that I was going to paint walls and basically do everything that was required to keep the place clean and everyone happy, you know?
Yeah.
And so I got to a pattern where I was doing I was doing a grocery store run every morning on the way to work. So I had to stop at a grocery store and fill my car up with like $500 worth of stuff every morning, because they had to go populate all the kitchens with fruit, cereal, all this other crap, bread and stuff, you know, milk, orange juice. So I did that. And then once a week I would do a Costco run to go get filler stuff like licorice, pistachio nuts, sunflower seeds, like snack stuff, you know. And then twice a month we had Costco deliver two huge bales of just stuff. It was like 1,000 pounds of food that came like twice a month, you know. And I ended up basically destroying two vehicles working there, because I wrecked my shocks and my suspension from carrying groceries everywhere and stuff, you know.
Wow.
Yeah, it was nuts. But so here's the thing, though. So they told me that if I made it to 6 months, they would give me a computer that I could work on my own time, and they would let me have access to the software and the rigs that were used in the movies and the commercials. And I was like, cool. So that was my goal. It was like, make it 6 months, you know?
Yeah.
So then Jan's boss, he was this little CEO guy, and he was a real prick. He was a total prick, and he hated me. Like, he really hated me for some reason. And he used to treat me pretty bad, actually. You know, he would drag me in the bathroom and like make me like clean the vents out with like Q-tips and stuff. He was just a little man with a little dick, you know.
Sounds about right.
Just a rotten person, you know. And
say that again, Wally. You broke up there.
Oh, I said he was just a rotten man. He was a little man with a little dick. So he used to just, you know, ride me all the time about stuff that he felt I should be doing, you know. And then one day he came to work, and he parked in the basement, which was part parking, part storage facility for all the garbage that they'd moved from a previous building and they put down there. Well, he backed his truck in, and he scratched it on a piece of fence post that was down there. And he called me up to his – he paged me. Back then we had pagers, and he paged me to come to his office. And I walked in there, and HR was in there with him, and I thought, oh, I'm fired. This is it. You know, I thought he was going to fire me. And so he sat down and explained what happened to his car, and he felt that it was my fault because I should have the basement clean. And so he put a piece of paper on the table and pushed it across to me, and he said, read this. And so the paper said that I had 2 weeks to clean up the basement to a satisfactory degree, or I was to offer my resignation. And I was like, okay.
fuck?
I said, fine. So I said, fine. You know, I signed it. And then I thought to myself on my way out, I said, fuck you, I'll do it in a week, you know? And so he said, you know, all your job duties are on hold for the next 2 weeks. You're in the basement and that's just your job. I was like, fine. So I'm down there and I'm just cleaning up crap. I'm literally like organizing boxes of like SIGGRAPH demo reels and portfolios, resumes, old computer hardware, just putting stuff on the shelves. They bought me a bunch of shelves to put stuff on. And I was just, you know, organizing that whole area. And then every day this lady was parking down there. And on the Friday, at the end of my first week, I'd finished my goal. I hit my goal of cleaning the basement up, you know. And this lady who I'd seen every day parked down there, she walked up to me and she just said, hi, my name's Patty. What's your name? And I said, Mike. And she's like, I've seen you all week down here. What are you doing? And I just told her what happened. And then she just simply said, do you want a better job? I was like, yes. I said, I'll take anything. And she's like, well, what is it you're trying to do here? What do you want to be? And I said, oh, I'm trying to learn animation. And she said, well, I can't give you that, but I can get you into production engineering. You know, we have a job opening for a render wrangler. You could render frames for departments. And I was like, okay, well, I don't care what that means. Just give it to me. And so she got me an interview with the team. And, you know, the whole afternoon I interviewed with them like a week later. And, each person tried to talk me out of it because they were like, you want to be an animator and be creative? This isn't creative. This is like technical. And this is like basically entry level programming, you know, because you have to know a lot of Linux and stuff. And I was like, I don't care. I said, you have no idea where I'm at in my life right now. I'll take anything, you know, And so they gave me the position and I became a render wrangler. And so they told me for the first year I had to work graveyard as my penance, you know, and basically my hazing. And said, I'll do whatever, you know. So I was a render wrangler working midnight to 8 a.m. for 365 days. And it was cool, though. I learned all about production. I learned how all the departments worked together to create imagery for this movie they were doing, which was ants at the time. And we were just finishing ants. This is just pre-Shrek. And so they taught me, you know, basically how to negotiate with departments on render farms, you know, like who needs render farm time, you know. And lighting is always like, we need lots of render farm time because we're lighters and stuff takes a long time to render. And then animators are like, well, we want render farm time too, because we're trying to get our dailies images out so we can get feedback, you know? So I had to learn pretty quickly how to talk to department heads and to negotiate and give them server time and then get their images to them. And it was actually really fun. I had a good time doing it because it was less learning than I thought, and it became almost robotic in a way, but I got to interact with people. And then what really got me was I got to then know the animators because I was rendering their frames every day. And so after a bit, you know, they gave me my computer with the rigs and the software, and then I started animating, you know. And so from the first... The very first character I animated was the Pillsbury Doughboy. I did a little, I did this little shot of him walking into a wall and then falling back on his butt and then shaking his head in like disbelief that he hit a wall, you know. And the thing was, it's like, for some reason, I didn't know anything about animation and I didn't understand acting or posing or shot structure. But what I did understand pretty quickly was I understood physics. I understood how to get weight in a character, and I understood the idea of overlapping shapes, even though I didn't know what that was called, you know. And so I immediately was like, I want to stretch this character and squash him into this wall, you know. And I had seen, of course, that in the books and stuff, you know, so I got the concept. But that part came easy at the time, you know. And then I just got a lot of advice along the way from people. It was great, you know. I remember Pat Hanaway was an animator there, and I showed her my run cycle of a rhinoceros. And she just gave me this great visual. She said, you know, imagine that you're sitting on the floor, and then there's a person across from you, across the room, and they've got a bowling ball, and they're going to roll the bowling ball over to you. But first, they got to take effort, and they got to push it away from their body, and then like roll it out, and then it gains speed. And then as it gets to you, you meet the ball, and then you cushion it into your body and slow it down. And then you do the opposite. You push it back out. And she just was teaching me about ease in and ease out, you know, and right. creating weight in the character, you know. And that was really like an aha moment of like, oh, okay, I think I get that concept. And so then I started like upping my game a little bit there, you know. But here's the thing, though. It's like that was – I was there 4 years. It was like going to college, you know. And I still didn't know anything about acting at all. I didn't know anything about
it. You're still doing this all on your own, right?
Right. Yeah, I was just working after hours. And I could only do it after hours. And so sometimes I would stay at work like 36, 40 hours. I would stay a couple of days sometimes and sleep on the couch, you know.
Walling, what was your love life like during all of this?
Love life. I mean, I was married at the time. I mean, I was married.
Man, I don't know how you like maintain a marriage during all that. That is like difficult. Right.
Yeah, you know what's funny? I actually talk about this with my students a lot. How that 4 years working there was probably the hardest time of my life at that point, and a lot of painful stuff, and like the financial loss of losing two cars and trying to get a new car to get to work the next day to do my job all over again, you know,
right.
And being treated badly and stuff. What's so beautiful about that is that it gave me a perspective, I think. And when I moved forward out of that time, I think I appreciated some things better than I might not have if I had just been given the job, you know?
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
But here's the thing too. It's like, I never had it easy though. I mean, even in animation, like you guys know, like it, like Blue Sky has always been my most favorite experience in my career, but it was super hard. I mean, I never really got the cartoony aspect of animation. I was much more of a Dreamworks type animator, I think, where I was better at doing natural or stylized naturalism, I guess you could call it.
Yeah.
So I think I fit that mold better, which is why I think I work pretty well at Bungie, is because it's a little bit more realistic, but it's keyframed realistic. Mm-hmm. So it's like still that stylized part of it. But animation was never easy for me, ever. I struggled a lot. And unfortunately, I spent a lot of time searching for my happiness. And so I had a tendency, as you guys know, I would hop studios like every 2 years. I'd get that itch like, oh, it's been 2 years. And I would start getting that itch of like, the grass is greener somewhere else, you know? And
How did you jump from render wrangler to animator then?
Okay, well, my wife at the time, she told me, you know, you need to do something with this. You know, it's been 4 years now. And I said, yeah, I know, but I'm here. I mean, I'm in the building, you know. Eventually they'll give me the shot, you know? And she's like, I don't think they're going to. And I said, well, I hope they do, you know? And then she just said, well, do me a favor, just humor me and send out your reels to just a few places and see what happens, you know? And so I did. I sent my reel to Blue Sky and DNA Productions in Dallas, and then two tiny little houses somewhere in Austin, Texas, I think, you know? And I purposefully targeted, most of the studios that I thought were small, so I could maybe get in there.
Yeah.
Thinking that maybe like a little experience I could get a start, you know? And then Blue Sky was one of those studios that felt like they were establishing, but they were still new in terms of like the feature work, you know? And so I tried to get into DNA or to Blue Sky as well. And then I got a no thank you letter from everybody except DNA. DNA called me and they said, hey, the owners, John and Keith, saw your reel and they want to talk to you. Do you want to interview for a contract animator position? I was like, yeah, that'd be incredible. And I said, cool. So go out to LA on your own dime and meet them. So
that's crazy.
Because we can't afford to fly you out there. And I was like, okay. And so I drove down to LA from the Bay Area and met the owners at the Shutters Hotel in Santa Monica, and they were doing voice talent recording is what they were down there for.
Okay.
And so they put some time aside to talk to me. And I gave them my demo reel and showed it to them. And they looked at it and they were cool. And they asked me some very generic questions. And then that was it. I was out of the hotel room in like 30 minutes, you know. And I went back to the Bay Area and just waited, you know. And then I got a call from this producer, Gina Shea, and she said, hey, the guys liked you a lot. They want to extend an offer. Just think about your number and call me back with a number. And just keep in mind that it's a contract. It's a contract gig, you know. And I was like, okay. And so I had a friend at PDI who was a financial guy. His name was Gary. And he was pretty cool about, you know, talking about money and stuff. And so I went over to him and I said, hey, what does an entry-level animator at DreamWorks make? And he told me a number and I was like, okay. I think he told me $60,000 at the time for like an entry-level PDI animator. I was like, okay. So I called this Gina Shea back and I was like, hey, I have a number for you. You know, thinking that she was going to negotiate with me, you know. And I think I told her $90,000, and she said, okay. She was like, that sounds good. I'll send you over a contract, and you can get it back to me. I was like, what? And so I went from making $13.50 an hour to my first contract gig at $90,000 for the year.
Holy
so that was pretty
shit.
Awesome.
That's fucking crazy. Awesome. That's
insane. Yeah, it was cool. So, but then the thing is, it's like, it's funny, because then you get to Texas, and you're like, wow, now I got to do this for real. And then they give you your first shot and you're like, how do I do this? You know? And
what were so you working animating. On?
Jimmy Neutron, the movie Jimmy Neutron.
Dude, one of my teachers worked on that.
Which one?
Sam Fleming.
Okay. The name sounds familiar, but I don't really
like,
remember the name.
He had long flowing white hair. I don't know. He might've been like, off campus. I don't know.
I have no idea.
All right. That's fine.
Yeah. I mean, it wasn't the most enjoyable time working there. I got to be honest, you know, it was a hard place to work at. I'd come accustomed to the corporate nature of DreamWorks and then to go to like the small mom and pop shop and they were just like, do whatever, you know, and it was just like, It was extremely surprisingly political, and so I had a hard time with that, you know. But I just tried to do my job and then go home, you know. And so so DNA Productions hired these two guys, Renato and Troy Saliba and Renato Dos Anjos. I think that's how you say his last name. They had just finished working on Titan AE for Fox. And they hired them to come out and teach the animators how to do step key animation. And they came out and they started working with us on this new way of blocking shots using step curves. And we had a hard time understanding like what the hell that was all about. I just straight ahead it. It was working fine for us. And they're like, it's not working fine for you guys. You guys don't know how to block shots out. You guys don't have any shot structure, you know? And so they said, just give it 3 months and you'll never turn back. And I was like, okay. And so they were pretty much right. You know, after a few months of doing it, it became like the norm for all of us, you know?
Yeah, it's crazy because I remember that time because I was still in college. And just the concept of blocking animation was so innovative.
Right.
It was just weird. It's like nobody knew what it was. And then it just slowly started to disseminate. Like, this is how you work in CG animation. It's very weird.
Yeah, and the way Troy taught it to us was he animated an entire scene with our characters in 2D on paper. He did it literally on paper and then just showed us the key drawings and said, this is all you're doing. You're using the software, but you're still just doing these drawings.
Yeah.
And we're like, oh, okay. You're doing a post test. He's like, yeah, the post test. There you go. And we just we springboarded off of that, I think, you know. And, you know, it was painful to learn, but we all got it, I think, and we all improved our production. Like, our quota increased, of course, and then I think the shots got better because we could actually pose them out instead of just straight aheading from, like, frame one and just starting movement, you know? So, yeah, so I finished the movie, and then we were all vying for a spot on the team to stay on and to work on the TV show. And I was lucky enough to stay on, but they cropped my pay down to like 50,000. And I was like, oh my God, it was hurt because I'd come accustomed to more money, you know? And, but I, you know, I was like, whatever. And so I worked on the TV show, and I remember like 3 years into that, I woke up one morning and I just said to my wife at the time, I said, I can't go to work anymore. I'm done with this place. And she said, okay, well, what do you want to do? And I said, this company, Blue Sky, is doing a movie on with robots in New York. And she said, okay, we'll apply. I was like, okay. And that was going to be the next, you know, challenge was like, well, how do I do this, right? And so I went to work. I went to work the next day and or that day, whatever. I was at work and I heard this guy talking to another animator and I was like, and they were talking in code. And I was like, he's talking about Blue Sky. I can tell. And so I waited till he was done and went back to his desk and I walked over. I was like, hey, are you going to Blue Sky? And he's like, what? No, what are you talking about? You know, he was like, no, no. And I'm like, come on, dude. And I was like, do you have any friends there that I could send a reel to? And he's just like, I'll ask, you know. And that was Michael Gargiulo. I don't know if you guys know.
Oh, yeah, Mike Gargiulo.
Yeah, Mike Gargiulo.
Oh, so shit. Pete's still on the podcast?
Yeah, I'm here.
Hi, Pete. Hey, buddy. So Mike Gargiulo contacted his friend, Ross Scrobel, who was at Blue Sky at the time, and he asked him if he could have a friend of his send him his reel, and he said, sure. So he came back to me and said, yeah, he said, fine. And so I looked at my work, and I was like, well, I have nothing to show because my first job was the movie, which was like a learning experience. And then the TV stuff sucks because it's like TV animation, you know, and it's like pose-to-pose garbage with a single breakdown for overlap, you know, and then very, very, very cliche gestures, you know. So I thought, well, I got to make a new reel. So I decided I'm going to give myself 31 days to make a brand new reel from scratch. And so I went to work at DNA one morning, like early. And all the PAs there had like these CD burners, and I just ripped every rig we had, and like dialogue, and like all these props and shit. And I took all this stuff home, and I went through all the rigs, and I found the best rigs I could find that we had. And then I got some dialogue and stuff, and I just started. All right, shot one, and I said, okay, let's see where I get in 31 days. And after 31 days, well, here's the thing though. I was so hungry to get out of there. I was so hungry at the time that I would animate every waking moment I was at home. So I'd get up early before work and I would animate for like an hour. Then I would go to work and I'd run home at lunch and I'd animate during my lunch. Then I'd run back to work. Then I'd come home like by 7 and I'd animate till like 2 in the morning and then sleep until 6 again, then animate for an hour. I did that for a month, you know.
That's and dedication.
Christ.
I had to get out of there. So after a month, I had animated 7 shots, and I was like, that's pretty good. And so I thought, you know what, let's do one more for good measure. And I did a monster 2-character shot from the movie Spaceballs, where he's like, what's the matter, Colonel Sanders? Chicken? You know, I did this whole dialogue shot with these 2 characters, right? And I sent my reel to Blue Sky, and they called me, and they wanted to fly me out for an interview. And I was like, oh, my God. So I was still working on that extra shot, and I wanted to bring it with me, you know, to show how dedicated I was. And so I remember the morning of my flight, I was still animating that shot, and I burned it to a disc, and I ejected it from my computer and, like, put it in my backpack, and I hit the road for the airport. And then I got to Blue Sky, and I, you know, they walked me around and showed me a bunch of stuff and put me in this room with, it was Aaron Hartline, Dave Torres, and Mike Thurmeyer. I think it was just those three. And they interviewed me for like an hour and we had a blast. It was super fun. It wasn't even an interview. It was like a bullshit session. Everyone was just laughing and stuff. And then the greatest thing happened. Someone said, Dave Torres said, what's your favorite shot on Ice Age. And then Thurmeyer was like, dude, you can't ask that. Like, that's not a great question to ask because, you know, like, that's not cool, man. And I was like, no, I was like, that's okay. I do have a favorite shot actually on Ice Age. And I proceeded to tell this about this shot I love and why I loved it, which was basically where Sid is talking to Manny and he climbs up on his tusk and then pulls his trunk over like a blanket. And then like Manny grabs him and like picks him up and drops him on the floor and it's like raining.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as I said that, they were like, oh my God, that's Dave Torres' shot. And they were like, of course, figures. And like, he's going to get a bigger head now. And everyone started like razzing Dave and like punching him in the arm and stuff. And it was a really fun moment, you know? And so, I said, I got one more shot I want to show you guys. And they're like, dude, relax, right? Relax. You're here, you know, just have a conversation, you know? So they finally looked at my shot and they're like, cool. And then they showed Carlos Saldana and he's like, that's cool. And he like walked off. he gave me like 30 seconds of his time to look at the shot and then like thumbs up and like walked off, you know?
Carlos, so that was it. The director of Robots.
Yes. No.
Yeah, he was a co-director on Robots. Okay. And then Ice Age 2, and then Rio, and right. Rio 2, and Ferdinand.
Right.
So
yeah, yeah. So yeah, that was it. I went back home, and then they called, and Brian King called me with an offer, and I had a migraine for 2 days from that conversation.
Wow, you actually got a call from Brian King?
Yeah, he gave me the offer, and he was hard on me, you know. Yeah. He was really hard.
He's our CFO now, so he's way above that.
Yeah, I don't think he would call people anymore.
No,
no way.
Does he do contract negotiations anymore? No.
No.
He was difficult. I remember dealing with him too. He was very hard to read.
Yeah, well, that was like his job. You know, he was a good negotiator for Fox. You know, he worked really well in that capacity, I think. So yeah, so that's kind of how I did it. You know, I just, you know, I made a decision and then just had to find a way to do it, you know, and work hard. My only regret is that, you know, it's funny. It took me until 2010 to realize that the majority of the problems I had in my life were me and not anything else. And it's like that thing where I kept moving and then I realized, you know what, these problems kind of follow me around. Maybe it's me that's the problem, you know? And it's like, I had to just like decide that, you know, it's not the studio environment. It's not the people. It's like, it's my attitude about, you know, what I'm doing and what I'm trying to learn and how I can grow as an animator, you know? And I think a majority of it was, since animation was never easy for me, it was always hard, you know. I think I struggled with keeping motivated because it was hard. It was just a hard thing to do, you know. And so when I got to DreamWorks, that's a whole other story too. My God, DreamWorks, man. Well, I mean, it's funny. All right, I'll delve into it a little bit if we have time.
Yeah, well, so you're at Blue Sky in 2000, what is that, like, four?
2009.
No, oh, no, the one? First time, 2004, right? 2003, right. 4 for Robots?
3 and 4, yeah.
So
yeah.
You're there for all of Robots, and then after Robots, you take off.
Right.
And
I had a baby. Dylan was born, and we quickly realized that we weren't going to be able to afford it there because I hadn't thought about daycare and stuff. And I was like, oh my God, this is actually expensive, you know?
Yeah.
And so I thought, well, I'll send my reel to my buddy, Troy, who was the one who taught me how to step key animate at DNA Productions. I knew he was at Sony. So I thought, well, I'll send him a reel hoping to get an offer that I can counter with Blue Sky, and the Blue Sky will pay me more money, you know, which I don't think I deserved at the time in hindsight, but I was trying my best anyway. And so I sent the reel to Troy, and then Pete Paquette found out, and he was like, what are you doing? Go to Sony. And he was like, don't trust those people. You know, and he was like, give me all this lecture about, and the funny thing was Pete mentioned two names not to trust. And I won't say who they were, but he gave me these two names. not to trust. And I was like, okay. And then I swear to God, man, on a Wednesday night at 7:30 p.m., I'm at home in Norwalk, Connecticut, and the phone rings, and it's like Sony Pictures Animation. I was like, oh my God, Sony's calling me. So I'm like, hello? And it was like, hi, this is so-and-so and so-and-so. And it was the two people that Pete were like, don't trust them, you know? And so
I was immediately... I know exactly who you're talking about, too.
But the funny thing is, I love that guy now. I love that.
Yeah.
Man, so.
Yeah, me too.
So anyway, so they were like, hey, we got your reel from Troy, and we just want to make you an offer right now. And I was like, oh, my God. You know, they just wanted to make me an offer on the phone. And I thought, well, let me parlay this a little bit. And I said, well, I'd like to come out and see your facility and, like, see what you guys are working on and, you know, meet the people, you know. And they said, okay, that's fine. So they flew me out to LA to basically, I didn't even interview. I swear to God, they took me into this room and there was all these people at this huge table, and they sat me down, and then each person went around the table and introduced themselves. Like, hi, I'm so-and-so. I'm the Hoka on this show. Hi, I'm so-and-so, and I'm the lead on this show. And they just went around the entire table, and then they asked me, what show do you want? Like, what do you want to work on? Yeah. And they just, which one do you want? And I was like, well... I said, can I get on Open Season? And they said, no, Open Season is fully staffed right now. It's screwed up. You know? And I said, well, I'll take Monster House because it's the closest thing you have to a feature film right now. And I said, fine, cool. And then I went back to the airport, and Carlos Saldana was on my flight.
Oh,
so,
really? Oh, man.
Yeah. So that was super awkward. And so I was honest with him. I said, well, I'm out here looking for a job because, you know, I can't afford New York anymore. So he was really cool. And he tried to get me upgraded to first class, you know, and he wasn't able to. But he was really cool about it, you know, and we talked for a bit, you know. But so I got back to New York, and then I got a phone call from Sony, and they said, hey, Chris Buck and Ash Brannon are doing a movie called Surf's Up, and they saw your reel and they want you on their project. And I was like, oh my God. So I get to work on a feature film. They're like, yep, if you want it. I was like, I'll take it, you know? And the money was almost double what Blue Sky was paying me. And so I couldn't turn it down. I had to just do it, you know?
Yeah.
And so we moved to Sony to go work on Surf's Up. And I ended up working on Open Season anyway, cause I needed help closing the movie. And then working at Sony for 2 years was the first time I realized that money can't buy you happiness. It helps, but it's not a one-to-one ratio with your happiness. And Sony was really hard for me because of the it was pretty political at the time, you know. And everything that Pete was like talking about was literally right in my face, you know. It was hard, you know. So I did my 2 years there, and then came back to Blue Sky to work on what?
Horton. Yeah. So yeah. That was my second movie at Blue Sky, and in the middle of Horton, people started calling back. I said, Mike Walling, Mike Walling's coming back, and I was like, who the fuck is this Mike Walling guy? And I started getting really intimidated, but like, this must be some animation god, and he's gonna come by, and in comparison, people are gonna realize I'm shit, and then I'm gonna lose my job. And I started getting like so up in my head about this guy named Mike Walling.
Which is so funny because it's like Jeff Gabor, you know, it's like.
The crazy part is then you and I became like fucking best friends.
Yeah.
right away. And I was like, oh, this guy's fucking awesome.
Yeah. And it's like. I met this guy, Jeff Gabor, and he taught me about orange juice lids, you know, how to throw them at each other.
That was the best, man. I mean, just as awesome. a quick sidebar, like all during Horton and Ice Age 3, Walling and I would sit across from each other, and we each had our own separate cubicles. Yeah. But we had a game where I would have every morning before starting work, I would go buy an orange juice from the vending machine, and I would take the lid and I would just toss it without looking, because there's like a little like barrier in front of my monitor, and throw it over the wall, aiming to go inside Walling's cubicle and hit him in the head. And of course, he would go back. And always the rule was, try to draw blood.
No, actually, I thought the rule was, try to draw blood, and no matter what, you couldn't complain about it.
That's right. It's your fault for getting hit in the head.
Right. It's your fault for bleeding.
Yeah. Let me ask then, how many headshots were there?
There was quite a few. Yeah, yeah, there was lots.
Yeah. I think he scratched me one time on the forehead. So. Well played, sir. Well played, you know.
It got serious. Like, I feel like I got really good at those lids.
Yeah, you had a knack for, like, doing, like, this, like, weird, like, over-the-wrist spin, yep. And it would, like, downdraft into my cube and, like, nail me in the face. It's like aerodynamics 101 or something, you know? Oh, and I actually missed that shithole of a basement we worked in was the best. It was so awesome down there.
Yeah,
and then we moved to the new studio, and I felt like something was missing from it was. That yeah. culture.
As much as we complained about it, there was a special energy that happened down there because mm-hmm. anything went.
Right, right. It was incredible. It was a great crew, man.
I was at something special. I brought it back.
You filled the void for the old building.
Yeah, that sense of this is awful but so good.
Yeah,
hey, Pete.
Yeah,
Pete. One of my favorite moments working in the basement down there was. Do you remember the story where you brought me into the treehouse and sat me down and talked about my martial arts black belt card?
I remember that.
I don't remember that.
Oh, how do you not remember? I remember it very vividly because I was right next to the treehouse and just hearing people start rolling with laughter.
Oh, dude, I thought Bruno was going to throw up. He was laughing so hard.
Well, refresh my memory because,
So I told you at some point that when I used to teach martial arts, they gave me this, like, card saying that I was I had to go to the police station and get my hands basically, like, they did a record on me, like, you know, I had my weapon.
Oh yeah, I remember now.
and so you're like, hey Mike, come into the treehouse, and you sat me down like, okay everyone, check this out, Mike Bowling has a black belt card and he's a lethal weapon or whatever.
Yeah, your hands were registered as weapons.
And dude, I'll never forget Bruno. Just like that laugh he does.
Yeah, the squeal where he starts squealing like a pig. Or he's just like,
yeah. Oh my god, it was so great. Yeah, but those are the moments that I love because it's like, I'll take any opportunity to embarrass myself to make anyone laugh, you know, and like, like, you think I'd be embarrassed, but that was such a great moment because seeing everyone just like laugh at me, it was like, I don't know, it was awesome, you know, and I always love those kind of moments, you know, because it's like, you know, who wants to just be like, well, this is just me. I go to work with my suit and I do my job and I love my wife and I bring her soup once a week when she's not feeling well, and that's my life.
So, your wife so is sick, like, pretty often.
So it was absolutely my pleasure to do like weird shit in life just to like make people laugh at me, you know? So it's like, why not, right? So
I have a specific memory that I associate with you a lot. We were at the Robots Rap Party, and everybody was fucking blind drunk.
Right.
And they rented out a nightclub, and we were all dancing, getting hammered and everything like that. Walling finds this long fucking balloon from somewhere, like this long, like, sausage balloon, and starts and takes it with two hands and starts like rotating it above his head, and he's making this sound like,
what the fuck?
It was so good, man. Oh man,
I literally do not remember that.
You were probably pretty drunk, dude.
I must have been very inebriated.
Yeah.
But I remember being at that party. Wait, was it that party? Wait, which rap party was that?
Robots.
That was, okay, yeah. I'm thinking of something else when Pete Nash was like super drunk.
Oh, that was the Robots Rap Party.
That was Robots? Okay.
Yeah, yeah. He was like all over the place.
So he was upstairs laying down on this couch because he was so super, super drunk. And these waitresses kept coming up and like picking up glasses by him. And every time a waitress would come by to pick up a glass, he would sit up straight. And then she'd walk away and he'd like lay back down. And then someone else would come by and like grab a glass and he would like sit right back up again and like just like look out. And he was super, super gone, you know. But yeah, that was interesting. That was my introduction to Nick Bruno and his wife as well. You know, meeting his wife, I think, for the first time at that party.
Right. Yeah. He didn't work on the movie, but he had just started Blue Sky in time to go to the rap party. Yeah.
Oh. Right.
Yeah.
But without a doubt, though, I mean, like my time, especially on Robots, was magical. That was the hardest show at the time I ever worked on, you know. Pretty much still, I think, is the hardest show I ever worked on. But the people that they amassed there for that production was incredible. It's like a once in a lifetime thing, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Like seriously, I mean, we were a family, you know, and like one of the worst winters New York has seen in like years, you know.
Yeah.
During that movie.
Wasn't that production especially hard too?
Yeah, I think we did 190 minutes of animation on that movie.
Right. Jeez. Yeah, like you. A whole nother version of the movie was ooped.
Yeah.
Right.
That was crazy.
But it was awesome. It was a good time. It was great. So then I'll do a quick segue then on how I got names. And I'll keep it superficial. But basically I you know, around 2010 I started, I think we just come off Ice Age 3 and I was severely burned out, you know. And all kinds of ways in life, let me tell you. Mm-hmm. I called Ryan Denniston at Blizzard and I said, hey, can I do a test? You know, I think it's time for a change. I need to shake things up, you know. And I'm super burned out. And so he gave me a test to do, you know. And then during that time, that's when Dreamworks called me. And I told Kim Mackey, the recruiter, I said, no, I'm not interested, and I'm trying to go into video games. And she was like, okay. And then she called me. She kept calling me. She called me like four times in a week, I think, trying to get me to talk to her. And finally I said, here, I'll send you my reel, and just if you leave me alone, kind of thing, you know. Mm-hmm. And then she gave it to Baxter and Dave Burgess and who else? Like Simon Otto. Dan Wagner, they all got it and they wanted to talk to me. And so they interviewed me and I went with them, you know, so I went to DreamWorks. But that around that time, I don't know, 2008 or so, I saw Tom Seville's demo reel for Halo Reach. And I was like, holy crap, they can do that kind of polish on a video game? Like, that's awesome, you know? So that's where I kind of started getting that bug to go do that.
But it's crazy. You're glossing over the fact that you're now coming full circle, going from cleaning out vents with a, you know, with whatever you said,
Q-tips.
Yeah, but now you went all the way back to DreamWorks as a fully fleshed out animator.
Right.
Like that's, yeah. That's pretty amazing.
It was cool. Actually, the funny thing was, a year before that, I think 2009, I went out to San Francisco to go do an animation mentor graduation, and I went by PDI to go visit, and I went back with my reel because I wanted to show Rex Grignon what I'd been working on because he was my mentor at PDI back when I was just this little kid, you know, this 28-year-old kid. And so he invited me in his office, and he called in Jason Schleifer to come look at it too. And they looked at my reel, and they were like, that's really great, man. Like, congratulations. And I was like, well, I'm sorry it's not better. I apologized for it, you know. Mm. And I was like, no, it's great. It's great. That's great work. And, like, think about it. You know, you were here before, and you weren't doing that. Now you're doing that. That's pretty great, you know. And so he said, let's go get lunch. And so he let Jason out of the room first, and then he put his arm on me and stopped me, and he squeezed me really hard on my bicep and said, if you ever fucking apologize for your work again, I'll kick your ass, you know. He's like, don't you ever apologize for your work. Think about where you've come from and what you've managed to do. And
then you're like, don't you realize these hands are legal weapons?
Registered weapons, yeah.
That's so funny. Yeah, so, you know, I was like, okay, I won't do that anymore. I'm sorry, you know. And then that was kind of it, you know. And then a year later, they were calling me to come out there and work with them, you know. So, but then in 2013, they had the big layoff. And I was one of the first three because our contracts were up in like a matter of weeks. And so they cut everyone with contracts ending first and then went up the chain. And so Robin Lynn called me like the day after I was laid off. He's like, come work at Real Effects. And I was like, God bless you, you know. And so I did that for 10 months. And then I went back to Blue Sky to work on Rio 2 for 6 months with you guys. And that was really hard, man. That was super hard for a lot of reasons. Part of which was just me being back there as a temp was really bizarre in a lot of ways because I didn't know how to carry myself. And I felt very awkward with the team. But at the same time, I met more amazing people, you know, and it was a great experience. There was no regrets there, you know. But when I came back from Blue Sky in like, I think December, January, I was in LA and didn't know what to do next. I was like, well, I'm kind of out of options right now. Like no one's hiring, you know. And then I got a phone call one morning from Sean Mullen, who was a storyboard artist temporarily at Blue Sky while I was there. And he was like, what are you doing? And I said, I'm literally sitting on the couch in my underwear eating cornflakes. And he's like, well, and he goes, well, get your ass to Salt Lake. And I said, well, what is in Salt Lake? And he said, Disney Interactive. I need a senior guy to come out and work on marketing stuff. And I'm like, let me Google this. I'll get back to you. So I literally went to Google and I Googled, what's in Salt Lake City? Because I was like, I couldn't even picture in my head what was there, like what it's like. And I was like, what is this place? You know, I never thought about Salt Lake, you know. And so I saw a bunch of stuff about Park City and snowboarding. And I was like, oh, that's cool. There's a lot of outdoor stuff there. So I called him back and I said, well, let's talk, you know. So the team interviewed me on Skype and we got along super well and it was very comfortable. And I said, I'll take it. Just give me the job, you know. And they said, well, we're going to fly you out. And I was like, no, it's cool. You can just give me an offer because I needed work, you know. So I needed money, you know. And then Gavin, the department head, said, listen, I'm going to be honest with you. I like to fly people out so that they know what they're getting into when they get here. I was like, well, I'm not really in a position to, okay, I'll fly out, you know. So they flew me out, and it was really comfortable. That was a great crew. I had a great group of guys out there. So I was like, yeah. So I went out there and did that for 3 years. And it was cool because I eventually took over the department when Sean left and got my first job set, like leading a small team of animators and doing marketing for the Disney Infinity video game. And so what's truly amazing, though, was, you know, my wife, Jen, and I, she worked there as well. She was a producer over marketing and layout and cinematics. And so we would oftentimes commute together and talk about our exit strategy. Like, you know, this can't last forever. The game is going to eventually not sell anymore. People are going to get tired of this game. We're going to move on. So we would talk about where we were going next, you know. And we figured we had a 2-year window before they were going to shut us down. And not even 6 months later, they called a department or a company meeting in the kitchen. And we all went down and they read the news. I mean, they read the press release about them closing us down, effective immediately, stop working, you know. And I sat there and I just started crying in the kitchen. And it was like my life was over. I was like, I can't do this anymore. Like I was so devastated that they took my livelihood away. And Jen and I were just starting to like make headway there. And like we were owning stuff and it was really great, you know? Yeah. And the studio said, well, because of the shutdown and the nature of it, you have 60 days of pay coming that we're going to pay you for, you know, normal, like every week for 60 days. And then you guys are welcome to come into the studio and use all the equipment to your heart's desire. Animate shots, make demo reels, do your thing. And so we did. So we kept going back to work every day, and we all worked on demo reels. We did animation tests for other studios. We all were trying to get jobs, you know. And then I remember a week after, the week after we got shut down, I put my reel up on Vimeo, and I was in the studio, and my buddy Nick was like, "Hey, Rick Lico just put his reel up for Destiny." And we're like, "Oh my God." And we always waited for his reels to come up. And so we all went over to Nick's desk, and we were like, we downloaded it, and we were stepping through his reel, looking at his work. And Rick Lico was the principal animator at Bungie at the time.
Right.
And so I literally was looking at his reel with my friends, and my phone vibrated, and I pulled it out, and it was a private message from Rick Lico, and I was like, and my heart dropped. I was like, oh my God, Lico just messaged me. And so I opened my phone, and it was from LinkedIn. And so I went to LinkedIn, and he had messaged me saying, "Hey, sorry to hear about Disney. Can you give me a call tonight?" And so I messaged him back like, "Yeah, I'll give you a call." And he gave me his phone number. And so I ran home that night, and I called him. And he just said, "Hey, man, nice to finally meet you. We both do animate, but we never have met." And I was like, "Yeah, man." I was like, "That's nice, nice to meet you too. I love your work." And we talked for a bit. And he goes, "So listen, I'm at Bungie, obviously." And he's like, "I'm leaving the company to go do a startup, and I need someone to replace me, and you're the guy." And I was like, "What?" And I was just like flabbergasted, you know. And I was like, "This is Mike Walling. You know who you're talking to, right?" And he was like, "Yes, I know." And he just said, "There's something about some of the work on your reel that I relate to, and I think you're the fit for this." And he's like, I "You're the guy. You just want you to know that I like what you've done with the Disney stuff, and you'd be a great fit." I was like, "Wow, that's amazing." I said, "Yeah, I'm definitely interested, you know." And so he put me in a phone interview with Bill O'Brien, who is the department head. And him and I talked for an hour and a half, like the next day. And we got along super well. And we were having a great conversation. And we were laughing. And it was like talking to family, you know. And Bill was beautifully not PC. It was so, it was just a very comfortable conversation, you know. And he just said, "Hey, would you do me a favor?" And I said, "Sure." He's like, "Would you do a test?" And I was like, "Of course, I'll do a test, you know." And I was expecting one. And so they sent me a test. And to do that test and to prepare for the Bungie interview, I worked harder than I ever worked in my life in terms of learning about their game and their character classes, weapon sets. I learned about what kind of like style they were. Like, I learned everything I could about the company. And I learned everything I could about first-person animation and abilities. And I did that for, like, a week up until the test, and then while I was doing the test, you know. And then I did the test and turned it in. And then I passed, and they said, "Cool, we're going to fly you out for an interview. And then Bungie will fly you out for 3 days to do an interview there."
Jesus Christ.
Yeah. That's crazy.
I mean, the interview is one day, but they want you to hang out and have fun. So they fly you out for 3 days. They put you up in a really nice hotel, give you a car. And then, so I went out for the interview.
Games are a different beast, man. They just are.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So I went out and I had my interview with them, and it was absolutely, it was very hard. It was the hardest interview besides... I did an interview once at Valve, and it doesn't compare to that, but it was hard. It was a really hard interview. It was very technical, and they had a lot of questions about my test, and they wanted me to like rip apart things that I knew were wrong with it, and they wanted to see if I matched what they felt and like how they felt about my work, you know. And I was pretty honest about the shortcomings that I knew were in like part of my test. And they were responsive about that. They liked that I called out some of the stuff, you know. So I just, that was it. I did the interview and went back home to Salt Lake and literally agonized in my waiting to hear back from them, you know. It was, I never wanted something that bad, I think, you know. And so every day I had to wait for a phone call was agonizing, you know. And then they called me and they said, I have an offer for you. And I was like, oh my God, you know, thank God, you know. So yeah. We talked for a bit and they gave me the offer and they said, think about it. And I was like, okay, I'll talk to my wife and then I'll get back to you guys. And then I talked to her and we said, yeah, we're going to Washington. And so that was a year and 2 months ago. And so I've been there ever since.
And then your beautiful game just came out a little while ago.
Yeah. Yeah. We're relishing in that surprise.
Surprise.
It's funny.
What's surprising about it? It's like AAA,
the biggest,
like,
game in the world.
Came out.
Well, Destiny 1 got so much, you know, criticism for its story and its characters and stuff.
Yeah.
And there are actually legitimate reasons internally why that happened. And they own up to it and they know about it and they talk about it openly. So, but here's what I mean though. So you make this game and you play test it, but it's broken, right? You know, there's always like bugs and stuff, and there's like temp audio, there's temp voiceover stuff. So you don't really get to see it polished.
Yeah.
And you think it's okay, like, yeah, it feels good, you know, but all the new UI stuff's not there yet. Like all the systems that are going to be like the new currencies aren't there yet. Like everything's temp, and like even like your engrams are all temp and stuff. So it's, mm-hmm. you don't get a sense of like what the game's about. And then suddenly the game drops and then we all play it at the same time the rest of the world does. They don't do us any favors there. The game is for the public, and that's a known thing at Bungie, is that it's for, not for us, it's for everybody else, you know. So and so we get the game and we play it and you're just like, oh my God, this is actually really different and really good. And you just get excited because you're like, wow, it's hard to see so many moving parts happening. You don't really get to see it until it's done. And you know, if you think about it too, you play test it and then it goes through final passes for 2 months before it even comes out. And so you see it 2 months later with all of the stuff plugged in that right. wasn't there when you tested it, you know. So
is it hard to do that? Because I feel like for me personally, I like to know what the end result is and like what I'm working on and how it fits in. Like just doing stuff, not knowing necessarily how it's going to play out, that seems like it would be difficult to do if you're doing it for a long time.
Well, I think it's difficult to look forward to the end result. You know, I think you have to just, like, for me, what I focused on for that first year was, well, let me just tell you too, like, Bungie is such a technical company that me having done so much feature film work, I was not prepared for the level of technical know-how there. And my direct manager is also my TD. And so he's a technical animator. And so he's pushing all this stuff on me too, to learn all this stuff, you know, and it hurts my brain every day, you know. I'm almost exhausted. I mean, honestly, it's the hardest thing I've ever had to do. And there are hard moments for me where I'm hesitant to let him know I need to do something because I know it's going to end up in a 4-hour guy at my desk walking me through all of these things that are very, very math based. Like, okay, let's go do some math. And I'm just like, oh my God, here we go. And like, you know, and we're basically quantifying, you know, values to time and throttle and all this other stuff. And what do we want to do here?
Michael's scrunching his nose. That gets me so excited. That sounds so fun.
Excited? Really?
Yes. Yes. I like the idea of interjecting math mm-hmm. and problem solving into animation. I love that.
Yeah. Yeah. But here's the thing, though. It's hard when you don't have context to anything. But now that I'm a year and a couple months into it, I have a different overall context on the bigger picture, and I'm like, oh, okay, I think I understand what we're doing here finally, you know. And so you're less hesitant to go do a harder thing because, you know, it's hard to do it. Like they're relentless in their pursuit of doing better there, and that oftentimes ends up meaning that you have to do hard things because that's what it requires. well, we want to do this kind of layered thing. Well, that means we have to do new technology and we have to go learn how to do this thing. And you're like, oh my God, that's going to be so hard. Right. And so it's hard to get in that headspace sometimes of like, yeah, let's go do it. Right. Cause you know, it's going to be months of learning and like doing it over and over again. And then my manager is so brutal. He makes me do things and then break it and then redo it again. Like he's like, and so, and cause they're invested. They're like, this is a long haul, man. Get used to it. This is never going to be comfortable. You're going to be uncomfortable forever. And if you're uncomfortable with being uncomfortable, then you don't need to be here. Are you comfortable being uncomfortable? And I'm like, yes, sir. Yes, sir. <You know? laughs> but it's remarkable. It's a remarkable place. They take care of their employees very well. And so
you've been there for a year and a half now, right?
A year and 2 months.
So where are you going to be in a year from 8 months from now?
Well, there.
He's still there, Jeff. Yeah. He has to answer that.
Yeah. No, I mean, here's the thing, and I half mean this. There's some seriousness here, but I do joke about how it took me 15 years to realize that I don't like feature film work. I feel at home doing this. I feel like this is what I should have been doing the whole time, probably, you know?
I will say there's an aspect of my career where I'm like, I'm still shocked I'm not in video games. Like, I love them so fucking much.
I mean, I just look at this podcast. Like, we should talk about animation a lot more, but it's like, who fucking cares? Let's talk about video games.
Yeah, and my entire cubicle is like, I'm surrounded by video games. And obviously, Pete, you're right now, you have probably close to 1,000 games sitting next to you.
Right. Yep.
And honestly, like, the future of feature films could very well be video games. Like, all the real-time stuff that's going on now anyway. Like,
sure. Yeah, and that's one of the most beautiful things about Bungie that I love is that the way they use this runtime rig in the engine, it just takes data from you and when you submit your shot. And so you can do whatever you want. I can re-rig my characters if I want. However I want, I can change spaces. I can put them in any space I want. I can switch back and forth.
Right. Okay. So it's just grinding out the data of the points.
Yeah. So you can go in there and you can rip the spine out and put a reversing IK spine if you want. Like if you have technical know-how, you can go and you can like re-rig your characters to do all kinds of locator tricks and do whatever you want. And then work the way you want to work. And then it just all bakes out in the end anyway, you know?
That's crazy.
It's pretty amazing. And that was actually hard for me at the beginning because I was like, well, I'm used to muscling through with my rigs and the tools you guys are using looks very complicated. And there's so many tools they use, it gets a little daunting. You can't keep track of them all, you know, and then trying to remember what you need a tool for when you need it is very difficult, you know? Mm-hmm. But then after a year, I'm just like, you know, I go home to go do a Maya thing for my class. And I'm like, oh, my God, how do I animate like this? I can't even work in this rig, you know. And that's when you realize, wow, actually, I've gotten used to that new tool set. And it's actually better, you know, than what I was used to before, you know. So it's pretty remarkable, you know. But, you know, I don't know. There's so many, there's like two sides to me. There's that side of me that's like, hey, everyone, go through the hard times to get to your goals because then you get perspective. But then there's also the other side of me that's like, you know, I think I spent so much time trying to find myself, and I think I just started everything too young in life, and I never had a chance to kind of get to know me. And so now I'm like older, and I think that it just took me a while to find that place, you know, and to find what I wanted to do. And I don't know. It's life is amazing that way, you know.
It seems your journey was worth it because you literally know, like, seems like you know fucking everybody in the entire animation industry.
I was going to make that joke that, like, Mike Walling is the Kevin Bacon of animation. Like, you cannot go two people without being connected to him.
Maybe in the 3D world, I don't know.
I don't know, man. With your letter to Glenn Keane, it's a pretty fast like connection there too.
Well, it's actually funny because we were having this guy I knew for years moved to Seattle, and he was like, "Hey, we got to get together." I was like, "Right on!" So we like had dinner one night, and then I introduced him to our crew because we have a lot of Disney people here who came up to work at other companies. And so we all kind of get together still, you know. And someone was asking me, like, well, how do you know this guy? And his name was Craig. And I was like, Craig, I don't even know how I know you. He just goes, he's like, dude, he's like, I came to DreamWorks like in 2010 and met you and through a bunch of AN people. And I was like, oh, right on. You know, it's like too many people over the years to like know, you know. And then like this other guy, Colin Brown, I helped him get a job in the Bay Area 3 years ago. And then he moved here. And then the same thing happened. It's like, someone said, how do you know Colin? And I said, I don't know. And Colin said, I was your student, dumbass. Like, you were my teacher at AM. And I was like, really? It's like, right on, dude. And it's like, it's just, you know, it's a long time ago. And there's a lot of people since, you know. But, yeah, it's weird. It's a small world for sure.
Yeah.
Good times.
That's I feel like a very well-rounded story about how you got into the industry and then how you worked all the way through it and then where you are now. And I'm sure your journey is not even close to being done. Not necessarily that you're leaving Bungie, but I'm just saying that I'm just saying, like, you have a career that's on the move and constantly like a part of this evolution. So
you know what's cool though?
Yeah, go ahead.
Please.
I'm just saying, like, I wouldn't be surprised that whether it's at Bungie or elsewhere, it's going to continue to morph and change. And I feel like you're quite the morphing animator.
Mm. Yeah. Well, it's interesting because I'm on this kind of unofficial track towards management here, where they have an expectation for me. And so me and my manager work through goals every 6 months. And the idea is just to find the thing. Do you want to be a manager? Do you want to be a lead? And let's do that. How do we get you there? You know? And then, so there's definitely an expectation. And I do have moments of like, man, can I do that? Can I do that here? Because, you know, these people, the people around me right now, like the guys I work with, the one who's been there the shortest amount of time is like 7 years into Bungie, you know? And so it's very intimidating because they just know all this tribal knowledge about the company and the software and all the tools. And it's intimidating. And you're like, well, how could I possibly manage a person who has been here 7 times longer than me, you know? Yeah. And so I don't know. We all just grow and we work through things and accept certain things and then, you know, try to grow into those roles, I guess, you know. But
I would say it certainly helps, you know, who you are as a person, why you've been in the industry and why you've been successful. Because I think wherever you've been, you've left a mark. And I think the reason why so many people know of you is because you're well-loved everywhere as well. So,
I was going to say the same thing. Like, the big reason why you've been so successful is because you're so damn personable.
Yeah.
Like, I knew your name well before we ever actually met.
That's funny.
Loads of stories about you.
Well, you know what it is too? It's like, I genuinely love people in my life, I think, you know, like, and I mean like the people I work with, I genuinely care about them, you know. I get very emotionally hooked on people, I think, you know, which could be good and bad, right? You know, but I think that, you know, I think that's part of it, is that, you know, I get attached to people. And so I think that, that's probably part of it, is, you know, and I think part of it too is just like the Blue Sky mark, you know. The people at Blue Sky are truly remarkable people. It's a remarkable entity, you know. It's like a beast of its own, you know. And I think unique personalities gravitate to that place, you know. I mean, like, think about it, you guys. Like, think about, like, 2003, like Jessica Sanchez, Dave Torres, Aaron Hartline, mm-hmm. all these people that we worked with, Amber and Luke Martorelli, I mean, like just amazing, amazing personalities, you know, all coming together. And then watching families grow out of them, like kids born and like people growing old together and like growing up, and then people kind of spread out a little bit, and then you meet some of them back in some other place, and then that group of people kind of flourishes, you know, and I don't know, it's amazing, you know, it's really cool. Blue Sky is my favorite memory though, for sure.
Well, I will say the weird thing about Blue Sky is the turnover keeps occurring, but the same feeling and the same energy keeps recreating itself. I don't know how that keeps happening, but it's pretty neat that all that.
I know why.
Me, it's the right? Core. Oh.
yeah, I mean, it's the core people, I think, you know? The core people carry that over. And then I think what it is, too, is I think, you know, all joking aside, because I know you wanted to laugh about that, but I think joking aside, I think you guys are good about vetting candidates, you know, that fit the personality types, you know.
Yeah, it's funny you bring that up. We just had an interview, and one of my main things was letting that person know it's like there is a personality choice between the different studios. And whatever you decide, whether we offer you a job or not, or if we do offer you and you decide whether or not to take it, it's about deciding for yourself if you want to fit in with the personality that is Blue Sky. Because it is, it's like if you're a person that wants to work at Pixar, you probably won't fit in here, at least at this moment in your career.
Right.
Because those are completely different personalities that would want one or the other, or at least who would be comfortable mm-hmm. in one or the other. Yeah. But
yeah. I mean, absolutely. I think both places are equally competitive in a lot of ways, you know, and very difficult styles of animation to do, I think. But
sure, yeah.
But I think that when I think of Pixar, I think of more of an individualistic point of view. And then when I think of Blue Sky, I think of Matt Munn doing the cinnamon challenge over there with the back scratcher across your backside if you fail. You know what I mean? It's like that. You know what I mean? That's like those are the moments that, you know, are so meaningful to me when I look back. Not what movie I worked on necessarily, but like I remember my favorite moments sometimes were like where Matt Munn at Sony Imageworks sitting adjacent to me, you know, he would just mess with me all the time. And he would made my 2 years there extremely bearable, you know, made me laugh a lot, you know? I don't know, people like that, man, they're infectious, you know?
Yep. Totally.
It's great, man. Great stuff.
Thanks for joining us on this interview. It's pretty awesome. Career path.
Easiest interview ever, too. Man.
Was it easy?
Simple.
Easy and fast. Well,
thank you for having.
Yeah. Is there anything else you guys want to say before we call this a pretty little piece?
Thanks for joining us, Mike.
Hey, how about one more quick story for the road?
All right.
Yeah.
We only have just a few more minutes, so.
Nice.
All right.
Just a few more minutes. I can't help but remember this moment in the new building over there when we were working on, I guess it was Ice Age 3.
Yeah.
And the email had come out that Queen Latifah was going to do a credit song at the end of the movie. And everyone was like, what the hell? You know, they pissed off. And Pete Paquette sends out an email to the whole department. Hey, I just found the song they're going to use. And I'm at my desk.
I remember this.
And I'm at my desk, and I see Brian King with a bunch of executives walk in, taking a tour of the floor. And the first person launched the link in the email that Pink sent out, and it was like this loud fart sound. and then somebody else hit the link, and then someone else hit the link, and next thing you know, it was like 60 animators launching that link. This was like fart sounds.
You could hear fart sounds rolling through the department with a series of laughs behind it. So good.
I'm so amazed I never got fired when I was there. Jesus.
Oh my God, but see, that's what I'm talking about. That is the magic right there. Truly, I mean, it's like those are the moments that got us through, but like a lot of those moments, like you know, and that's truly magical. So thank you for that. That was a great day.
Oh man, I got reprimanded for that. I remember that.
Dude, it was worth it, man. It was worth every slap across your behind, you know. So
yeah.
All right. Well, I'll let you guys wrap it up here.
Yeah. Well, I feel like we barely touched the your depth of stories and whatnot. So maybe we can have you back on the show sometime.
Yeah.
Yeah. Actually, I was just gonna say I wouldn't mind just popping in just to like banter sometimes.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Totally, man.
Yeah. It's too much fun. You guys are a blast, and Michael rounds out the group very nicely.
Oh, thank you. I'm the young with blood.
Your blatant cynicism about, you know, most things is refreshing.
Thank you.
Yeah. Here, just real quick, too. I was listening to the podcast last week, and I woke up the next morning, and I was like, I thought I had a dream about Jeff and, like, these fish, and I realized, oh, wait, no, that was for real. That
was totally for real. Oh, yeah, he definitely was fucking those.
Yeah.
And I was like, what a weird thing. Like, it was so weird to me that I was like, did I dream that? No, that was in the podcast. Jeff likes fish.
That's right. So, I do. Yeah.
All right, gentlemen.
Yes. All right. Thank you for joining us. Anybody that's listening to this, like, you know, let us know if you like these kind of podcasts where we're doing these interviews. We'll continue to do them if people want to listen to them. I don't know who the hell else we'd have on, but
We'll find someone.
Yeah, we'll find someone.
We'll figure it out.
I mean, they're going to get progressively less interesting.
Well, maybe we could go up. We've had some pretty high-profile people hanging around Blue Sky lately.
There you go. Tap one
of them on the shoulders. Yeah, John Cena. Yeah, John Cena. We'd get him.
Yeah, no problem.
All right, well, this has been Just a Few More Minutes podcast where three veterans of the animation and video game industry talk about exactly that, animation and video games. So
sometimes the fourth one.
Oh, yeah. There's Mike Walling and there's Michael Berardini, and there's Pete Paquette, and me. I'm Jeff Gabor. All
right. Supervising animator.
you don't like that ending.
No.
Mike's not digging this.
No. Don't say our name.
Oh, by the way, those of you who are interested, I don't know if Jeff is going yet, but I'll be at the Retro Gaming Expo in Hartford, Connecticut this October 14th.
Yeah, I'm planning on going. It's just, can my back hold up the car ride?
No, we're gonna host a whole show.
Yeah, we're gonna do a live podcast.
I just made that up.
Yeah, we're not doing that. I'll probably wear my just a few more minutes podcast shirt though around the convention. So
cool, man.
If you see a guy with spiky hair and a
fucked up back,
that's me.
That's awesome.
All right, guys. Thanks again. And Pete, why don't you hit that music?
All right, man. Later, guys.
All right. Peace.
Bye.